Hello dear students, welcome to the history class. I hope you all are doing good. Today we will learn chapter 2, New Kings and Kingdoms. In this chapter, we'll learn basic points like emergence of new dynasties and kingdoms. That is how royal families came up. We will learn about Gurjara and Pratiharas. Rashtrakutas, Chauhans. Here there were many dynasties, but we will learn few. Then we will learn how wars used to happen for wealth. In this topic we will learn about Muhammad Ghazni and Muhammad Ghori's invasions. Then we will learn how new kingdoms were started in a new way and how the administration of these kingdoms were carried. A closer look we'll learn about Chola dynasty in South India, which was one of the biggest empire in South. In elsewhere we will learn about China's Tang dynasty. In the first topic of the chapter we'll learn the emergence of new dynasty. Emergence means rise and dynasty means royal family. By 7th century there were big landlords or warrior chiefs in different regions of the subcontinent. Landlord means zamindars, that is one has a big land, he is the owner of vast area and he collects tax of that land. In our civilization we had many such landlords, also called warrior chiefs. The existing king often brought such landlords under their rules or kingdom, and the landlords were acknowledged as their subordinates or samantas. Samantas were expected to bring gifts for their kings, and he present at their court and provide them with military support. With tax, samantas also had to send their army whenever king had a war with another kingdom. These three were the basic work of samantas: giving gifts to the kings, being present in the court, and giving army whenever king needs them. This is how samantas were under the kings. As samantas gained power and wealth, they declared themselves to be Mahasamanta, Mahamandaleshwar. If any samanta had immense wealth, power, to show off the same, he declared himself Mahasamanta or Mahamandaleshwar. This way, he showed how powerful he was. Sometimes they asserted their overlord, such as Danti Durga of Rashtrakuta in the Deccan declared independence from Chalukya Empire of Karnataka. If the Samanta had immense power and wealth, they would be under someone. He used to declare himself independent. He used to tell king that he was not a part of his kingdom anymore. He would not be giving tax to the king. He would keep the tax for himself. Also, he would not support the king by sending his army. Samanta would have his kingdom separate and independent. In the same way, he have an example of Samanta named Danti Durga of Rashtrakuta in Deccan, who was very powerful, who declared himself independent from Chalukya Empire of Karnataka and declared himself a king. Let's have a small information or story about Danti Durga. In this chapter we will learn or we will come across many kings. They were great warriors and a great personalities. they have their own life stories, but we can't describe much as we have limitation taking chapter into consideration. So let's have a small instance of the life of Danti Durga. In the mid 8th century, Danti Durga, a Rashtrakuta chief, overthrew his Chalukyan overlord and performed a ritual called Hiranyagarbha to become a king. In the mid 8th century means around 750 AD, as end of the 8th century will be 800 AD. Danti Durga, chief of royal family known as Rashtrakuta, defeated Chalukya overlord and himself became a king. But after winning too, Danti Durga had an obstacle, as he was from a Brahmin family and only Kshatriyas could be a king. So to become a Kshatriya and then a king, he performed a ritual called Hiranyagarbha. This is how Danti Durga became an independent king and formed his own kingdom. Now let's learn about the ritual Hiranyagarbha, also called as the golden womb in English. This ritual was thought to lead to the rebirth of the sacrificer as a Kshatriya, even if he was not a Kshatriya by birth. This ritual had some ceremonies in which giving sacrifice was a part. As Hiranyagarbha was a religious ritual, the one who does the ritual was taken as he had a rebirth in Kshatriya caste. So with this ritual, the performer who was not a Kshatriya would be considered as Kshatriya thereafter. This ritual was not meant for everyone. Either Danti Durga was a Brahmin, so performed the ritual and became Kshatriya, but a Shudra could not perform this ritual and become Kshatriya. In fact, in those days, Shudra were not allowed to get inside the temple. They were not allowed to read or say any mantra. If it happened that the Shudra heard any mantra, a liquidified lead was poured in his ears, and if any Shudra uttered a mantra, his tongue was cut. So such rituals were only for higher caste people, not for Shudras. In the other cases, men who were good warriors who could lead an army created their own small kingdom by clearing big forest or occupying barren lands and setting up villages and civilization. This way also many kingdoms were created. In the same way, Kadamba Mayura Sharma and Gurjara Pratihara Harishchandra, who were Brahmins, converted themselves to Kshatriya and took up army and became warriors, also established bigger kingdoms in Karnataka and Rajasthan. Kadamba Mayur Sharma had his empire around Karnataka and Gurjara Pratihara empire was around Rajasthan. Next topic is warfare for wealth. Which means fight for acquiring more wealth. The king who fought among themselves did not fight for any personal grudges but for acquiring wealth. Since 700 AD to 1200 AD, there were three big empires in northern part of India. One was Gurjara Pratihara Empire, on one Rashtrakuta Empire, and third Palas Empire. These three were very big and prosperous empire. In between these 500 years, these three empires fought between themselves for Kannauj, one of the prosperous city in that times. All three empires wanted to have control over Kannauj. This fight in the north was also called an Tripartite fight. Struggle between three empire for Kannauj. When the empires had immense power, army and wealth to show of their prosperity, they made big temples. These temples were symbols of their prosperity. These temples also showed how good artisans the empire had. The houses were very small and simple, made of mud and wood. But the temples were very huge. Even gold and silver was used to make it look grand. As these temples were extremely rich, like the idols were made of gold, silver with diamonds in it. Apart from this, the donation of gold, silver and precious stone was accumulated in these temples. So these temples were targeted when one another kingdoms were attacked. So now, why did they need this gold and silver, this wealth for? They needed wealth for prosperity of empire, to make army more bigger and stronger, so that they can acquire more kingdoms and become more powerful and wealthy. This was like a cycle. If we have wealth, you will have big army. If you have big army, you will conquer more kingdom. Again, you will have acquire more wealth and then can maintain bigger army. This cycle would go on. We had many invasions for looting wealth in our civilization. Means many other civilization people came to our civilization, looted gold, silver and wealth from our civilization and carried it to their civilization. Our civilization has faced many invasions. The first to invade the Indian subcontinent was Sultan Muhammad Ghazni. The image is the first image of the left side is Muhammad Ghazni. The Sultan Muhammad of Ghazni from Ghaznavid Empire, which was located in Central Asia and Iran, can refer the images given in the slide. From far distance, he invaded almost every year. It is said he invaded 17 times. He traveled through Afghanistan, Pakistan and reached Gujarat and looted Somnath Temple, which was one of richest temple of that time. It had lot of gold, silver and wealth. He carried all the wealth to his empire. This was one of the big examples of invasions of our civilization to another civilization for looting and acquiring wealth. Now, as we are learning about bigger empires and royal families of our Indian civilization, we learnt about many royal families: Palas, Rashtrakutas, Gurjara Pratiharas. Now let's learn about a special royal family, that is Chauhans. Chauhans ruled the north part of India in that time. Chauhans had many great kings, but as we cannot discuss about all kings, we will learn about one king, that is Prithviraj Chauhan III. He was one of the greatest king. There are many stories about his life, but here we will learn about his one incident of his life, because this incident has set a big mark, or can say impact, on the Indian history. In 1191, a king from Afghanistan named Sultan Mahmud Ghori attacked on Prithviraj Chauhan's empire, in which he lost the war. He ran away saving his life and returned after a year in 1192 with a bigger army. This battle is called as Battle of Tarain. This time he was lucky and won the war, as Mahmud Ghori won the whole empire came under his control. What he did after winning the empire? Mahmud Ghori did not rule the kingdom. He looted gold and wealth and carried it back to his empire and appointed his slave Qutbuddin Aibak to rule Delhi. Made him king of the empire that was taken from Chauhans. The Chauhan Empire was in Delhi and around Delhi. From Qutbuddin Aibak, the royal family originated in Delhi. This dynasty is also known as Slave Dynasty. Images are given for reference and better understanding. We will stop our session 1 here and continue rest topics in second session. I hope you all have understood the so far chapter and topics. Go through the textbook and its topics, listen to the video, read the slides, refer images for better understanding. Thank you. See you in next session.